Welcome back to the Arise interview, where we speak to the newsmakers as well as ordinary people doing extraordinary things around the world and featuring the voices at the heart of the stories. I'm Charles Anyegulu. Now, you may know that food security is a big problem in Nigeria because, quite simply, the country doesn't grow or process its own food as much as it ought to. And when it does produce food, it's doing so at a very limited subsistence level. So naturally, the quality of food that is available to the greater population is not as rich, diverse, or nutritional as it ought to be. And that's for a whole host of reasons, from poor investment in research and patterns of climate change to the fact that people are growing the same things that don't work anymore. So in order to tackle some of these problems and also take advantage of the enormous business opportunities that are potentially there, some international firms are partnering with African food scientists and local farmers to drive the transformation of agriculture on the continent. One such company is Shine Bridge Global, headquartered in Chesapeake, Virginia, USA, which is working with Nigerian food technicians and farmers to achieve this goal. We'll speak to the firm's Nigerian chairman, Dr. Tony Bello, in a moment. But first, here's a clip of him talking a bit about what he and his company are aiming to do in Nigeria.
We are in Tulare, California.
This is Dr. Tony Bello.
The world needs what you have. You know how to farm. There are places all over the globe that don't know how to do what you do.
Dr. Bello is a prominent food scientist who's enhanced and created products at Kraft General Foods, Kellogg's, and Frito-Lay.
And I'm in the sciences. I'm a food scientist, and I create foods.
Products such as Kellogg's Live Bright Bars and Baked Lay's Potato Chips. At the World Ag Expo.
There's quite a lot going on, we know, in Nigeria right now. A lot of the farmers are starting to modernize and buy farm machinery.
Dr. Bello shares his passion.
My vision is to help create jobs.
We are going to feed the world!
Yeah! Yeah! We can do it!
And help to eradicate poverty in the world. Agriculture is my vehicle to doing that.
And the place where Dr. Bello wants to start is his home country of Nigeria.
Coming from a very small village in Nigeria and owning my own farm at the age of 10, I could be one of the farmers who are still back in my hometown today doing subsistence farming.
To help realize the vision, to bring food processing technology to Nigeria, to create jobs and feed people.
We have a group of experts who are waiting to share ideas with our Nigerian counterparts.
And Dr. Tony Bello, who you saw in that video, the food scientist and chairman of Shine Bridge Global, is with me now in the studio. Thank you very much indeed for joining us.
Thank you, my pleasure, Charles.
And of course, since that video was made some time ago, you've moved forward beyond the idea and you've now realized a lot of that. You've been part of a group of companies investing in Edo State. Tell us about that.
Thank you so much, Charles, and thanks for having me here. Quite a pleasure. I see you up on television out in Chesapeake, Virginia, and here we are live and in person.
Brilliant, isn't it?
So this is great. I come from Edo State. I grew up in a local government area now called Asan Southeast, specifically Ubiaja, where we grow cassava. My grandmother processed cassava into garri, into akpu and what have you. Mm. 40 years later, 50, 60 years later, we are still on the akpu and garri, not good. And so this is the drive. Mm. We have the issues of food security. We have the issues of insecurity that is following. We have the issues of a lack of jobs and unemployment challenges. So what can we do to create opportunities? Let's think about the opportunities over the challenges. Mm. And this has driven us to working with the public-private partnership. And we, no one can do this just on their own. We must learn to work together on a strategic partnership platform. And this is one thing that we have done very successfully in Edo State. And thanks to the sitting governor, Godwin Obaseki, who has provided the enabling environment for us to invest in large-scale cassava farming.
Right, so tell us exactly what you're actually doing there and what kind of monies you're investing.
Very well. Well, we're looking at $150 million USD in the industrialization of the cassava value chain in Nigeria. We are going beyond what people read in the literature, what you pick up on the internet. We are going after consumer packaged goods. At the end of the day, it is really about shelf stomach. Mm. As disposable income goes up, people want to go to ShopRite and disperse. They want consumer packaged convenient food. So we see an opportunity there to transform cassava way beyond the high quality cassava flour of 5-10 years
right.
ago.
So is it processing factories that you're establishing or and then down the value chain, completing the packaging and all of that?
Very well. Yes. So first is, what can we do to boost the manufacturing capacity of existing factories right here on the ground in Nigeria? Mm. So we have partnered in Edo State with three local processors. What are the issues and the challenges they are facing? Supply security, competitive pricing, lack of knowledge of traceability, issues with global food safety standards.
That's a critical point.
This is the part that we are bringing to the local partners. Let us help our local partners to grow first and foremost. And then we would invest our own monies in new processing facilities and new manufacturing facilities.
And at what stage is that now? Because I know you guys held a big online event with the governor just a few days ago.
Yes.
What stage of development are these things that you're talking about?
Very well. So we have mechanized farms, large scale, ongoing in Edo State as we speak, in a place called Obiaja and Oria. That is on the bottom level. We're engaging about 860 smallholder farmers. Taking that, we have our partner in Abia State. And so we've partnered with the Federal Ministry of Agriculture and Rural Development on the Agri for Food and Jobs Plan. So as platform partners, we are managing almost 10,000 smallholder farmers. We have our processors injecting capital to help upgrade their facilities in Edo State. And we are now being wooed by other states to see what can we do to collaborate. This is where the opportunity of aligning our goals and vision with that of the African Development Bank on the special agro-processing zone becomes a real winner for scale and for speed of delivery.
That's very interesting. I'm almost tempted to give up this job and go into farming myself.
Come on down.
I like that. Come on down. So in a sense, you could say that you're putting the wind behind the sails of Nigerian agriculture. And the challenge really is to make agriculture a business on an international level. And that is the way that you create opportunity for millions across the continent.
That is correct. It is creating value where experience and hands-on experience, not theoretical, meets the investment opportunity. So we're bringing in the capital with the full support of the United States government on promoting trade and investments in Africa, of course, starting with Nigeria. Mm. And this is where the American food science and technology transfer becomes very critical.
Absolutely.
How do we reapply the technology for making Pringles, potatoes, crisps.
And you were doing that, cassava. Weren't you? I mean, you were doing it with Kraft and other sort of
people. Indeed. I think I brought some products here just to give us a flavor of what transformation and industrialization really means. It is taking cassava, making high quality cassava flour, but make it a functional material that can be processed at industrial scale. So you are producing some of these products at 2,000 pounds, 2 tons per hour. This is the kind of scale. How do you make that material become machinable? And this is the food science and technology piece that seem to have been missing for a little bit too long in our society in Africa.
But it's always been the problem, though, isn't it, with Nigeria and other African countries, that they're just a commodity-driven society, that they produce the raw material and they don't go down the value chain.
Correct. I think one thing we have done very well for ourselves as Africans, and I grew up in the 70s, went to high school in the 70s, when there were federal government scholarships. And most of us who were considered to have made good grades had the opportunity to study overseas. So I am a product of that. And going overseas 4 decades later, this is really the perfect timing. And we're beginning to see the level of technical leadership and vision that it would take so that we can reapply some of these proven technologies to our staples, to our commodities.
And you see a direct, clearly discernible link between the rising level of youth unemployment and food security concerns.
Absolutely. And I think it's time to change the lexicon. For too long, we've talked agriculture. Agriculture is the means to the end. What is the end? It's the food. It's the food we put in our stomach. And so if we are talking to the youths and to our young ladies and boys and girls and to our women about the food and the consumer packaged foods, it is a much more attractive proposition. That, in my opinion, is what would drive mechanization.
Yeah, because a lot of people,
that is what drives scale.
In their minds, they're thinking of, you know, that image of the subsistence farmer, and you've got your hoe and you're sort of digging up roots and things. And but the other, the end, the bit you're talking about is considerably more sort of attractive, and that's the opportunity that you are talking about, that you want to deliver.
Absolutely. We happen to have our children in the United States. They don't know where the farms are. They go to the grocery store to buy the food.
Absolutely.
And this is what we need to expose our young people to, that it is not just about the production side of science, but it is the processing, it is the science, it is the marketing, is the digital technology, is the packaging, is the artificial intelligence, process controls. That's the way to attract our youths into the food ecosystem and the food economy in Africa.
Stay with us. We'd like to talk with you some more. You're watching the Arise interview. Plenty more still ahead as we continue our chat with Dr. Tony Bello, chairman of the US-based company Shine Bridge Global, that's working with other food and agro-allied services firms to co-invest in the cassava value chain in Nigeria. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Arise interview. I'm Charles Anyagulu. Now, as awareness of the potential of the agribusiness industry in Nigeria and West Africa continues to grow, more international companies are throwing their considerable leverage into the development arena. Many, like my guest today, Dr. Tony Bello, food scientist and chairman of the U.S. agribusiness firm Shine Bridge Global Incorporated, are raising risk capital and are investing in research and in finding new solutions to Africa's age-old agriculture problems. According to analysts, that has the potential of radically changing the way the sector operates and helping local farmers to not only close the yield gap, but also generate production that at once assures their security and generates a surplus. It's a sort of modern-day green revolution aimed at promoting large-scale high-intensity scientific agriculture as a way of increasing economic growth. And Dr. Tony Bello, food scientist and chairman of Shinebridge Global, is still with me in the studio. Thank you very much indeed for staying with us.
Thank you, Charles.
Tell us a bit about yourself and how you became a food scientist.
Wow, what a question. It started in high school. I loved agricultural science. And
I thought you were going to say you loved food.
agricultural science, at least at the time, right? And I was 10 years old when my uncle first took me to my farm and said, this is your plot, and you will grow yams, melon on this plot at the age of 10. And in high school, I happened to be good in the sciences and in mathematics. And naturally, when it came time for going to college, I really couldn't gain admission into a Nigerian university, just 6 universities at a time. The other option was apply for a government scholarship to study overseas. So I applied for food science and technology. Luckily, I was fortunate enough to be awarded a federal government scholarship. Upon getting to the United States, I thought dairy technology, the goat milk farm at Ubiaja was my inspiration. And in talking with the manager, he indicated he was a dairy technologist. That's what I went to study.
Okay.
But after my bachelor's degree, I realized I wasn't really good with running around the animals. I preferred the lab coat. And so I went into food science proper and became a starch chemist. And so my PhD is out of Texas A&M University. And understanding of material science of starch became the thing. And somewhere along the way, my career path took me through potatoes. And I have become a world expert on potato processing. When the issues show up, one way or the other, it gets to my desk. And I have learned over the years how to manipulate potatoes. And so now is an opportunity to do for cassava what we have done for potatoes in the West.
And why cassava?
That's an interesting point. Number one, starch is the predominant component of every cereal grain, of every root crop. The chemistry of potatoes and the chemistry of cassava are very, very close. I believe that the good Lord gave to the temperate climate potatoes and to the tropical climate cassava. While we have created a $25 billion U.S. processing market for potatoes, cassava is merely $4.5 billion at a global scale. Why is that? Because we in Africa have not done what the West has done with potatoes. So my goal is to make a small difference.
That's
and let's
brilliant.
Close that little gap there.
That's a very, very interesting, very enlightening analysis. So how do you channel all that raw energy of Africa's youth into productive and profitable agribusiness so that jobs are created and incomes are generated?
Very well. So my advice is to our youths, when you go into ShopRite and go to the snack food aisles, and think about this, these products are made from wheat flour. The same base commodity for making bread is what goes into the cookies, it goes into the crackers, a wide variety. Have you ever thought about what does it take to turn wheat flour into this great tasting cake that you are eating at the wedding?
Oh, I love cakes. You're making
this
me hungry
is the way.
Now.
This is the way to think about it. And so the industrial ingredients that comes out of the commodity is number one opportunity. So instead of importing Let us focus on our own staples. Nigeria, number one producer of cassava in the world. And a big thank you to our smallholder farmers. They made us famous in the world. But with our youths coming in and seeing the ready-to-eat food and bringing in their knowledge, their talents, their innovation, their ingenuity, we would compete with the West every day, anytime,
and I believe jobs, in our
and most
and improve the economy. And correct. In terms of what gets in the way, the reproaches, if you like, mm-hmm. of achieving what you're saying. Mm-hmm. I understand that the two big challenges or barriers are the lack of access to land for many people mm-hmm. and the lack of access to financial facilities.
Mm-hmm. I really think when you read from a development point of view, those actually appears to be the major issues. But during the Dr. Akinwumi Adesina years, where I happened to have served as his senior technical advisor on agribusiness, we did a study. That study showed otherwise, because we interviewed 75 agribusinesses across the country. Four or five key challenges. The one that is most related, number one, infrastructure, finance, as you've indicated, but the supply security. Critical one. You must have security of supply of your raw material. This is why most of us are now going back to the land. That's when the land shows up. Inconsistencies in policies, government policies and regulations. But this for me is the biggest one. The lack of human capital development. It is people who have the experience. And I'm not talking about foreign expatriates. I'm talking about local talent, the diaspora community, our smart graduates and intelligent, innovative minds working together and learning together and growing together. And let us work with the government. There's no state governor when you bring a bankable deal to that would not want to create the enabling environment. Enough of this thing about government bringing the funds for us. Let's go to the capital markets. Let's go source the funding. And that's exactly what we are doing. But the key is partnership. You have a little bit. What I bring is a unique knowledge of food science and consumer packaged goods. My partners, African Global Schaefer, Dr. Mima and his group, you've talked to Dr. Mima before. Yeah. They bring in the financing aspect of it. I know a little bit about government here, so we have local consortium partners.
Right.
Arts Consulting on Project Boat, Berwick Agro on Project Boat, Zeal Host, we have formed a consortium of six local partners to work with our U.S. counterparts. Okay. This is how we are moving things forward.
Well, as it continues to develop, do come back and talk to us and give us a sense of the progress that you're making.
Thank you so very much.
Dr. Tony Bello, food scientist and chairman of Shine Bridge Global, thank you ever so much.
Thank you, Charles.
That's it for this edition of the Arise interview. Join us again tomorrow. From me and the entire team here in Abuja, bye-bye, and thank you for watching.